time from President Kennedy to President Reagan and now President Trump, every time we cut the taxes, then things start taking off because people have more money, and it's their money, they ought to keep the money. So what I propose is we cut our taxes, well, it'd be 15% on our income tax, and I want to eliminate retirement pay for government retirement pay for law officers, for first responders, for veterans. And we got a lot of veterans in South Carolina. Per capita, I think we have more than anybody in the country. We got 9 military reservations. We have a strong, strong military tradition in South Carolina. And all of that leads to good, strong people, and it leads to the support of this kind of industry, the aviation industry. By the way, if anybody seen the paper, it's the SpaceX project where this man is shooting a rocket to Mars, and he's got a red convertible sports car attached to it in Dallas. Anybody see that? And they got a dummy, a real dummy, not a person, got a dummy right now in a sports car, in the red sports car, and I think he said he's waving, got his hand up, and he's waving, and he's playing David Bowie music as he goes. Who would have ever thought that would be happening right now? And that's a part of aviation. And I'll tell you, that what that says to me is that the sky is the limit. There's no limit. The human imagination is something that's got to be used. Most of us spend our time imagining a cascade of horrible things will happen to us and how horrible everything's going to be. But everybody with sense says you can't do that. Be thinking about the good things you can do and imagine what progress you can make and how far you can go. And if we try to do that, then you take a good look at South Carolina, you see that's exactly what's happening here. Because we are going right straight to the top. And this industry, the presence of Boeing, of course, has changed everything. The presence of BMW has changed everything. I believe the presence of Samsung, which takes us yet another step in a slightly different direction, is going to change everything. Those big companies can go anywhere in the world, anywhere in the country, and they all come into South Carolina. According to the statistics, when Boeing arrived in 2009, we have cemented ourselves as the top destination for the aerospace and aviation industry. More than 400 aerospace and aviation companies, which contribute 53,000 jobs and $9 billion in economic impact. And those are good jobs. Those jobs require skills. And fortunately, in South Carolina, we got the wherewithal to provide those skills for our people. And that's in the best technical college system in the United States. Everybody knows that. When I talked to these people as Lieutenant Governor for 2 years, a little bit as Attorney General, but mainly as Lieutenant Governor and Governor, I had talked to a lot of people I didn't even see a new exist except in magazines. And they all telling me the same thing. They say they come into South Carolina for a lot of reasons. One is because of the ocean out there and because of the mountains. And also the research universities. We have 3 of them, MUSC, Carolina, and Clemson. And they're off the scale in innovation and imagination. And also their willingness to partnership, have public-private partnership with these companies. Where they do research, you have the students and these PhDs doing this off the scale research. And these companies realize that that's important. They also know that our technical college system, best in the country, started in 1961, is the only one in the world that will send a team of people to any country in the world that wants to build a plant here, wants to come and do business here. We'll send a team to go look at their plant, to look at their manufacturing facility, see how they do it, see what kind of training they need, and set up a program here in South Carolina at one of our 16 colleges to train people to do that for free. We're the only people in the country that do that. And that's what one reason they're coming. But the main reason they're coming, oh, I forgot the port. And just we're starting to dredge it now. It won't be long. Our port will be the deepest on the Atlantic coast. New York, New Jersey, they're raising the bridge, so they'll be able to get the big ships in there too, like we are. But we in the port of New York, New Jersey will be the main ports on the Atlantic coast in almost no time, just a few years. You don't have that anyplace else in the country. And also in South Carolina, we have 2 what they call inland ports. And that is, from Charleston, you have CSX running up through Dillon County and across I-95, a heavily trafficked road. And that means that you can, someone in a truck can drop their load in Dillon, put it on the train, and go over to Mike or Charleston, get on the ship and go out. And the same thing in Greer, where Norfolk Southern runs from Charleston, runs up through I-85, which is also heavily, they're about to wear out I-85. And it would wear out I-95, but everybody goes so fast on it, that's another story. But nobody has got a good inland port like we already do, and nobody's even contemplating having two, which we will have as soon as we get the one in Dillon fixed. But these companies, they look and they come here for that reason. They also come because of our low union participation. We're the lowest in the whole country, and that's going to be treating employees as well. And you remember at Boeing, they had a vote recently to go union, and more people signed up to petition to have the vote than actually voted to have the union come. It's a remarkable thing. It's a great signal to the rest of the country. And by the way, way back when Boeing was thinking of coming to South Carolina, a lot of the naysayers were saying, well, no, none of the workers up in Seattle, they don't want to come to South Carolina. Now, I understand there's a waiting list of about 1,000. Everybody wants to come to South Carolina. And you've been reading about how Scanner's having trouble, having electric power problems with the building of those nuclear reactors. I can't tell you how many inquiries I've had from big companies, much bigger than Scanner and Santee Cooper put together, that are interested in buying a piece of South Carolina. Everybody wants to come to South Carolina. But the main reason all these companies tell me that they're here is because of the people. And the best quote, although I've heard it many times, came from the chairman of BMW at the 25th anniversary of BMW up in Greer. But of course, they put the cars on the inland port, and it took you the line that goes right straight to Charleston, and they ship them off. By the way, you know how many BMWs they produce up there a day? They produce one every 61.7 seconds. A brand new BMW rolls off the line. I mean, y'all, we are ahead of the rest of the country. But that man said, and I quote, he said, "The reason we are here is because of the people of South Carolina. South Carolina is a handshake state. When someone in South Carolina gives you their word and shakes your hand, you can depend on it." And he says, "You don't see that anywhere else." Now that was news to me. I knew we were friendly. I knew that, because we hear about that all the time, and we still do. The people in our state will look at a total stranger walking down the street, and some look in the eye and say, "Hello, how are you, ma'am?" and all that. So that just comes natural to us. But it doesn't come natural to everybody else. But that dependability of our workers and the strength of our workers and the strength of our ability to work together to make things better is something that sets us apart from the rest of the country. And there's a new paradigm in manufacturing that's developing here right now. And that is between these research universities and these big plants, these big manufacturers who do a lot of research, and they want a partnership up and collaborate and have those students working with those researchers and those PhDs. But also now the technical colleges are getting into it as well. So you have a major company that does a lot of research. You have a major research university, and you have a high-powered technical college all working together. In fact, at Clemson, they have an advanced manufacturing building up there. And I know it's the only one in the country. It may be the only one in the world. Maybe the only one in the world where you have PhD professors, PhD researchers, and other researchers from a company working with master's candidates, PhD candidates, bachelor's candidates, as well as technical college students and high school students that have dual enrollment with the technical college. That's top to bottom. Going into a new direction where in these manufacturing plants, they don't carry toolboxes anymore. They carry laptop computers and tablets. You could go to work in these big plants. I've been in wearing a tuxedo and go to the ball that night, and I didn't look like I've been working. It's a different kind of a world. But the aviation industry, what's going on here in the aviation industry is nothing short of miraculous. So what I intend to do is to get our taxes as low as we can, keep them low, 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 because I believe from what I've seen and what I've learned is that's the way to prosper. Keep taxes low, let people keep their own money, and then they will spend it, and they'll spend it, usually spend it very wisely. They spend it the way they want to, it's their money. Let them spend it how they want to. But we need to keep taxes low, we need to keep the people safe. That means we have to have good law enforcement. And I'm telling you, we've got excellent law enforcement in South Carolina. I'm going to see to it that SLED has whatever resources they need for their laboratories, that they have plenty of time and money for training. One other thing I'm going to see to it is we don't ever have to worry about having a sanctuary city in South Carolina. I think that's the thing we've got to do. As Attorney General and U.S. Attorney way back under Ronald Reagan, I've tried to listen and learn a lot, and that is, and Rudy Giuliani was around then. He and I worked together way back then. You remember he was the one, he had the broken windows approach. That is, if you're in a neighborhood and there's a broken window, you fix it as quickly as you can, because one broken window will lead to another, and before you know it, you got a crime wave in your neighborhood. So you want to nip these things in the bud. So that's what I learned, is that with what they now call sanctuary cities, if there's a place where someone who's broken the law, doesn't matter what the law is, if they have a place, a safe haven, where the authorities will not enforce the law, what does that do? That causes more people to go there that have some reason to not want to have the law enforced, which leads to more and more, and it's the exact opposite of what Rudy did. So we're not going to do that. I want to keep our people strong. I want to get them educated. I know we have to have good teachers, good principals. That is the essence of good education. But it all leads to the same thing, and that is economic prosperity and growth. And I believe, that if you have great economic prosperity and growth, if you have people with good jobs, good paying jobs, where they're looking to go to work in the morning, then a lot of our problems just disappear. Domestic violence goes down, marriages go up, divorces go down, drug uses go down, crime goes down, everything gets better. The core of the strength of our state and of any state in this country is people working who are skilled, who are trained, who are doing work to provide for their families in a safe environment, a safe, clean environment. So that's what I'm here for. That's what I want to do. I'm pledging to you that I'm going to do everything I can to see that happens. And I'm also going to do all I can to see that this aviation industry, the manufacturing industry, the education here in South Carolina, but the aviation and all that you impact thrives in South Carolina, because that is the core of our strength. And I want to thank you again for inviting me. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Thank you. One of the happiest things I get to do is recognize South Carolina. And there's so many, there's not enough awards to go around, but we do have one that is called the Order of the Palmetto. It's been around for about 50 years, I think. And the purpose of it is to recognize someone who has excelled and contributed to the happiness of life in South Carolina on a statewide or regional basis. And we have a number of people in our state who have received this award. Is something that is given with great consideration as a nomination process, as a research and confirmation process, and then it's all analyzed, and it's not something that is given lightly. So I am here to make this presentation to Paul Wirtz. for 38 years. He started in 79 as a state planner, and he held that for 25 years in program manager, responsible for implementing a series of new systems that won the Most Innovative State Award from the National Association of State Aviation Officials in 2001, became interim director and now executive director. And he expanded the infrastructure at public airports throughout the state and overhauled Title 55, which is very important, leading to the Most Innovative State Award again in 2014. And his passion, his diligence, and his ability to get things done is legendary in many circles. And it is a great honor for me to be able to present to you on behalf of the 5 million people in South Carolina the Order of the Bound. Thank you.
My dad took me up to the Newberry Airport, and we flew up there. Kenny and Pam, the Pilots Association, reached out to the kids at that time. We flew. Who would ever thought that about 10 years later, I would be working for some of the best people in this industry? I couldn't do it without good people, like this commission that I worked for, to the staff. But you know, God gave us 2 ears to hear people, and I'm trying to listen to everyone in this room at some time. You may not see things eye to eye, but I listen to you. God gave me 2 eyes to look at the good of people, and I look at you guys. But God gave me 1 voice, 1 mouth, and I just want to say thank you. And for all the public service I've been able to accomplish, I thank you for it.